Good afternoon. I'm Elizabeth Sackler, and it's wonderful to have everybody here today. This is our final program of our spring, if you can believe it's spring with the snow outside, and it is snowing, actually. It is in Manhattan anyway, it's not in Brooklyn. But this is our final program for our spring series of States of Denial, the illegal incarceration of women, children, and people of color, and I welcome you. If you missed the previous two panels, one was Burning Down the House, Rebuilding Juvenile Justice Together with Burning Down the House author, Nell Bernstein, and a panel of Brooklyn-based prisoner advocates. Or if you missed last week, Prison Women in Change, a conversation with Ngechi Taifa and Susan Rosenberg, who's author of An American Radical Prisoner, Prisoner in My Own Country. Susan talked about her nearly two decades of incarceration as a political prisoner and what it was to be incarcerated for your ideas. Susan was released in 2001, or she would still actually be incarcerated. She was released in 2001 through executive clemency by President Bill Clinton. You can view both of those programs, if you missed them, at www.brooklynmuseum.org/EASCFA/video, and I encourage you to do so. They were wonderful. In 1862, Dostoevsky wrote, "The degree of civilization in a society can be judged by entering its prisons." That in the House of the Dead. And 150 years later, I think it is still a true benchmark. And in our country, abominations continue in prisons and jails day after day without any repercussions. People are isolated to insanity. 70 million people who have been incarcerated face laws in our country today that completely disenfranchise them and guarantee those laws do the dissolution of an entire population of peoples. So I ask, where is the civil in our civilization? And if you haven't seen it already, New York Times Magazine section is finally taking this question on. It was online yesterday, it's now in the magazine section today. And it's on American prisons called, the title is Inside America's Toughest Federal Prison. It's by Mark Benelli, and I'd say in comparison with the radical humanness of Norway's Halden prison by Jessica Benko. And if you know anything about Norway's prisons, you know something about a civilized country and the way in which a civilized nation handles people who have not behaved properly. But we'll go back into society and be productive human beings, which is really what we need to strive for. For 6 months, I led a workshop up at York Penitentiary. It's a women's maximum security prison up in Niantic, Connecticut. And the fruit of our labor created by nine women is a wonderful work of art entitled Shared Dining, by women of York, and the women were inspired by seeing photos of the dinner party by Judy Chicago up at the Sackler Center here, and of honoring women that they cared to honor. And Shared Dining will be on view here this August in the Sackler Center's History Gallery next to its big sister, the dinner party. So I invite you and urge you to take note because it is quite an extraordinary work of art by a group of very extraordinary women. The power of art cannot be overstated. To heal and reveal, the power of art to express and sometimes express the otherwise inexpressible. Author Wally Lamb has for over 10 years led writing workshops up at York and published two books of writings by those women. Couldn't Keep It to Myself in 2004, and I'll Fly Away in 2008. And I'd just like to read you a short poem written in prison by Kimberly Walker. Its title is Lavender and Vanilla. Mom lies still in the hospital bed, lavender and vanilla radiating from her skin. Spirit at peace, body at rest, she is in her father's arms. Upon her face, glorious light shines. The wind blows, I love you, kisses. The rain falls, tears of I miss you. The scents of lavender and vanilla say, I will always be with you. She was not with her mother, and she was. Today we are Inside Out with Piper Kerman and Joe Loya in 2004 during her year in prison. Piper began a correspondence with a then stranger, Joe Loya, who had served 7 years in prison for bank robberies and who survived 2 years in solitary confinement by reading and writing. During and after serving her sentence, Piper, Loya encouraged Kerman to write honestly and with humor about her experience, and without regard for established ways of thinking about crime, punishment, and prison. And I have the pleasure today, really, of welcoming the two of them in conversation about memoir, about prison narratives, and the life-saving and life-changing power of storytelling. It had occurred to me earlier, and I mentioned it to Joe just before we began, that there is a moment when you have a, when you reach a critical mass and things shift. And a lot has been bubbling up. And of course, Michelle Alexander wrote The Great, The New Jim Crow. And with Piper Kerman's Orange is the New Black, both the book and the Netflix series, suddenly there has been a shift of a major, major sort. And so much is going on now in recognizing the inhumane treatment and the horrors that are taking place right in our front and backyards. And part of the reason that we have this ongoing series is to continue to talk about all of the things that need to be talked about and things that some people don't know about and sometimes things that people don't want to know about. So I will read you their bios. Piper Kerman is the author of the best-selling memoir, Orange is the New Black, My Year in a Woman's Prison, an account of her 13-month incarceration for a drug, a decade-old drug offense, and the now popular Netflix series. Piper is a communications consultant for nonprofits and philanthropies and serves on the board of the Women's Prison Association. She is a frequent speaker at colleges and universities and has recently addressed groups including correctional officials, federal probation officers, public defenders, justice reform advocates, and volunteers, and formerly and currently incarcerated people. She is the recipient of the 2014 Justice Trailblazer Award from the John Jay College Center for Media Crime and Justice. Joe Loya is an author, essayist, playwright, actor, and soon to host and produce his very own podcast, The Allure of Crime. His op-eds have appeared in national newspapers. He has done commentary on television and radio, lectures at colleges across the country, speaks with prisoners here and abroad, and with Walden House to help former prisoners re-enter society. While serving 7 years in prison for bank robbery, he began to write his life story, which eventually became The Man Who Outgrew His Prison Cell. Loya has received a Sundance Writing Fellowship and the Sun Valley Writers Conference Fellowship and a Soros Justice Fellowship. Loya is currently working on a memoir about daddyhood. and his commitment to raise his kid to do well despite his past commitment to behave badly. Tell Me a Zombie Story is also the story of how he prepared his daughter from childbirth for the day he'd have to tell her he'd once been incarcerated for bank robbery. And it occurs to me that we have to thank Joe for having encouraged Piper, nagged her, and rooted her on to write Orange is the New Black, so that all of you and all of us will hear the two of them speak today. And I'm very happy. Please help me join in welcoming Piper Kerman and Joe.
Yes.
Hello, everybody.
Oh, comfortable. Uh-huh. Thank you all for coming out.
Yes, and thank you, Elizabeth, for that really lovely introduction. Thank you for that warm Brooklyn welcome on a snowy spring day. hello, my friend.
Hello, my friend.
Really, I think what y'all are about to participate in is an ongoing conversation that's been taking place for over a decade. And it's nice to be here with you.
It's very humbling always to be in the situation like this, because I remember it started off with a correspondence, and it was just letters, and we were strangers, and I knew what you were going through, kind of, not specifically, and then you would give me information, and now we're here, and it's, and everything, the book and everything.
Yeah. So in 2004, I was incarcerated in federal prison, and I was very lucky because I got mail. And at mail call, every single day, every single person on the unit shows up, right?
Absolutely.
Because everybody wants a letter or a postcard.
You crowd up.
A magazine, mail call, like anything, some sign from the outside world, right, that you have not been forgotten. And I began to get letters from a complete stranger, because my friend Laura out in California had put out an APB, hey, my friend Piper is incarcerated, please send her books. And you did not just send me books, you began to send me letters, what I would describe and characterize as demanding letters. and you said, hey, I'm Joe, I'm Laura's friend, I did a lot of time. And you began to ask me questions, like all kinds of questions, questions about my fiance, Larry, that I found, you know, from my WASPy perspective to be like, oh, well, you know, who are you to ask me that? He said, you know, Joe said, how do you think this experience will change your relationship with Larry? What do you think about when you think about getting out? So many questions that were intense and personal and pointed. And the other thing that you began to say to me in those letters was to write, and you related a little bit of your own story.
Yeah.
And so that was a great comfort to me, and maybe you just tell people a little bit about like what you described in brief, because those letters tended to be like, long, you know, a page or two, and believe me, if I didn't respond fast enough, Joe would write again and be like, why didn't you write me back?
Like, I'm not gonna get the excuse, oh, I don't have time, you know, I can't write you back. I got nothing but fucking time, give me time. But more importantly, the thing is that I had done time, and in time I had relationships with people who visited me, and I had love relationships, people who loved me, and that I eventually intended to have a relationship when I got out. So I was tending to my my connections with people while I was in there. So I'm always interested when people are inside and we're talking about the component of how you're existing in here, but also what's going on with your connections out there. How are you managing those? But also what I understood is once you hit prison, the density of that experience totally jogged. Like you could go in WASP, you can't stay WASPy. You're like, or even me, I went in there with this real sense of like, I'm smarter than everybody here, I have better education than them, I'm more savvy, and nothing could be farther from the truth. I mean, the first time that I got there, and I had been playing chess and memorizing Bobby Fischer, Boris Spassky games, like in sixth grade, I was like a little chess champ in my little junior high. And I go there to prison, and some guy who has no teeth, and he's 68 years old, and he beats me soundly, like within 5 minutes. I was like, that was my introduction, like, there's some very savvy, clever guys. I'm not gonna be the smartest guy here, especially when it comes to thinking ahead. Mm-hmm. So I feel like what prison does is it has this great thing where it breaks you down and puts you in flux so you can start making connections with people in that time and start thinking about things differently than you had before. Mm-hmm. So my thing was, you're in there. I know you're going to be in there for a while. I know what you know you don't know yet. And I know your fears. I know the people around you. I know all this stuff already. And in my letters, I was basically candid. I said, nobody who will talk to you about anything you're going through right now will understand you better than me. That's just, and because I'm a stranger, it's even better because I had a correspondence in prison for 2 years, my last 2 years, with the writer and essayist Richard Rodriguez. And we wrote and wrote and wrote. And in those letters, in fact, he never visited me. I never called him. But those letters, we confess that it's easy to confess to strangers. You can tell people that you don't know all sorts of stuff. You can't tell your family. You can convey fears, but you don't want to tell your family because they're going to say, oh, my God, I should start worrying. This person's worrying inside. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of things like that. So I felt like I was going to give you that opportunity, and then I was going to give it again. I was going to, you know, and I'm an ex-bank robber. So one thing I do is, like, I transgress borders easily, you know? Like, I jump. I've been, like, you know, I have priors for jumping over boundaries and, like, teller stations and stuff. So, like, when it comes to me and people, I don't have a problem saying, hey, hey, hey. And that's what I was kind of doing, urging you think about writing.
Yeah. So those letters told me that, you know, writing essentially saved your life in a lot of senses, or certainly transformed your life. Maybe it saved your sanity and transformed your life. That might be a more accurate description.
Yeah.
While you were incarcerated. And so you were really urging me to write while I was incarcerated, which I did end up doing in the sense that I wrote copious letters and very occasional journal entries. But I didn't start writing my own sort of narratives while I was incarcerated. But you were encouraging me to do so, and you were describing, I think, really clearly in those letters why the power of writing was transformative for you.
So the thing about, for me, writing had actually helped me organize my story on the page. Mm-hmm. So what I had up until going to prison, I was just this person who acted. I was a person of action. And I would get angry, and I'd get prompted to do something, and I would just focus, okay, I'm going to go rob a bank, or I'm going to go hurt this person, or whatever. And how I was functioning was my life were these memories, these kind of discrete memories running around. Something would happen. It would trigger a memory, and it would come there. I'd remember something horrible, humiliating. It would incite the rage, and I would act. So these memories were, like, not connected to each other, mm-hmm. but they were there, and they were very powerful. When I started writing the stories out individually, the death of my mother, you know, different traumas or different things I'd done in my life, and I started putting it was like a puzzle. And all these things that I thought I was because these stories had once, I had identified them as this or this or this or that, I saw that they were all connected. I could start recognizing patterns in my life. And more importantly, what I saw, there was like evidence that once upon a time I'd been this decent kid. And that was the startling epiphany in prison, mm-hmm. that, wow, I actually forgotten a lot of the beautiful things in my childhood. And it was exactly that reminder that said, I think that is still in me somewhere. And rather than, like, start thinking about sort of appropriating some things that I could be better, I felt like I just needed to find a way to let that thing assert itself, let the goodness in me assert itself. Mm-hmm. And that's all, writing all these stories from childhood and, like, really beautiful story before my mother died and before my father went totally demented and really violent. They were powerful in enacting change in my life. Mm-hmm. And letting me see myself really in great detail, my story with the bad and the good.
So your book was published during the year that I was incarcerated. Yeah. So eventually that book came into my hands while I was incarcerated. I remember you were so shocked. I wrote to you that I had your book, and you were so shocked. You were like, how do you have a hardcover book? But when I read that book, I began to truly comprehend just how different in many respects your story is from mine.
Absolutely.
In that you experienced a ton of childhood trauma, as you just alluded to, you know, mm-hmm. your the death of your mother and then your father's reaction, which was really to go towards a place of great violence, not focused on you, focused on your brother. And the trajectory that starts perhaps leaping off from that moment when you stabbed your father in the neck, and leading you towards a path of robbing 21 banks?
30 banks.
30 banks.
30 banks. I robbed four in one day once.
For which you were eventually incarcerated, and your incarceration was actually a lot more tumultuous than mine, because just tell a little bit about how that 2 years of solitary confinement came to pass.
Yeah, so when I went to prison, you know, my thing was I was still a criminal. Mm-hmm. I was like, you got me, but all I'm going to do is I'm going to spend these 7 years actually rising in the ranks. I'm going to become, you know, I'm going to, because I went to federal penitentiary and I was in maximum security penitentiary, I met every member of every mafia in the country, from the Dixie mob to the, you know, the Aryan Brotherhood to the Irish, Italians, Colombians, you know, everything. So I felt like, okay, good, I'm in my space, I'm going to rise in the ranks, I'm going to become a better criminal. And for 3 years, well, approximately 3 years, I still was committing crime in prison.
Mm-hmm.
But
are most people in prison.
Yeah, like, I mean, that's how you survive. You have so many
rules. Exactly, right.
Yeah, I mean, if Fruit Man smuggles a sandwich from the kitchen and I eat it, I mean, that's, you know, that's,
correct.
That's a violation, that's a crime.
Right, there is no survival in prison by following the rules.
No, you can't. So, but we were doing other things. We were doing like various kinds of like making knives and all sorts of whatever, everything. But I go to solitary confinement, and in solitary confinement, I get pulled in for this homicide investigation. My ex-cellmate was murdered, and they pulled up a little group of Mexican guys, and I'm in there, and I'm for the first year. I'm like, you know, I'm earning my bones. I'm actually it's helping me to have this aura of who I might have been involved with this part of these guys who could have done this.
To embody this story.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So, but I'm in there, and solitary confinement as that article was actually very challenging for me to read that article again.
I can only imagine.
It was really, really horrible. Solitary confinement broke me. And when I came out of prison, people would ask me, well, you know, you changed your life in solitary confinement. Why don't we lock everybody in solitary confinement? I said, the paradox of solitary confinement was that it was the worst thing that ever happened to me. I literally hallucinated. I was hearing voices. But it was also the best thing that ever happened to me. And paradoxes are like that. So I never say one without the other. Mm. This bald boy was in the corner of my cell and shocked me. So I was so stunned how I had lost my ability to see reality and fantasy, to recognize the difference. That it broke me. That broke me. It humbled me and made me realize what I know about myself now. Everything is up for grabs. Everything of who I think I am, what my strengths are, and up until that point, I thought I had a really, really strong mind, but it was challenging. And that's where solitary. I started turning into writing every day. I wrote about that boy. In fact, that was the first story I ever wrote that made into the memoir. It turns out that when I was seven. There was a seven-year-old boy who had leukemia, who was my neighbor, we rode bikes around, and then he died 3 months after I met him. And we used to play in his house and everything. And that boy triggered the memory of that, and that's where I went in earnest, started writing all these stories about my childhood, when my mother was still alive, when she was healthy, and that's where all these memories came back. And I wrote that, and it was painful, but it was so urgent that I had to write the next memory that came from that, and write, and then I was writing every day.
Yeah.
Basically writing every day till I got out of prison, the next 3.5 years, something like that.
Yeah, so I read your book, and I was like, oh, okay, I get it. I understand why Joe has been encouraging me to write, because writing literally saved his sanity, literally transformed his life. And your book is really not just about your time incarcerated, obviously. In fact, I think on balance, you know, it's at most 50% about incarceration and the experience of incarceration, and gives us this incredibly beautiful portrait of you as a child, you as a rising and changing adolescent, and then, you know, brings us into that experience of incarceration and really, really closely into the experience of solitary confinement and what life on that solitary unit is like. And one of the things that I think is so interesting about your depiction of the shoe and not just your own internal experience, which you just described so beautifully, but the interaction between all the other people in the unit is that it's told with humor, which is not what we expect when we think about the torture of solitary confinement. And we all, more and more people recognize and acknowledge that any lengthy period of time in total isolation basically functions as a form of torture.
It
and again,
torture.
This New York, the most recent description of the Florence Supermax super isolation unit gives you a really clear picture of why solitary is so disturbing. That said, the way that you chose to write about the experience offers an access point for those of us who have been fortunate enough, including myself, never to set foot into an isolation unit, which I think is really unique. And I think that is, from my point of view, one of the most important things for people who choose to write certainly prison narratives, but also narratives that relate to human rights abuses and to really traumatic experiences, is how can we find an access point for those who have not shared those experiences? And I think you made some fascinating choices in your book.
I did. You know, when Orange is the New Black, the TV show came out, I read a couple things, and people were like, there were some folks who didn't like it for whatever reason. And I wrote a piece for Medium about it, and like not only defended, you know, the book, but also the show. And my greatest defense of the show was people I knew I'd spent time with in prison. And Rob McClary, are you here? No, so I have a friend who lives here in Brooklyn. He was gonna try and make it. He's the guy I did time with. When I was in prison and friends knew I was writing to Richard Rodriguez and they knew that he was asking me, when you get out, we want you to write for us. We want you to write about your experience. My friends would tell me, when you get out, tell them how we're funny. Tell them how we laugh. And that was like not one person, not two people. One of the things we don't like is in the way people are characterized, prisoners are characterized, including serious criminals. I mean, a lot of murderers I know are actually, were some of the funniest guys I met. I felt like I needed to treat prison like a dramedy because I laugh so much. In fact, I was notorious for my laugh. People could take a track where I was in the unit by where I was laughing. I have a really bellicose laugh, and I throw my head back. Even my 8-year-old daughter laughs like me now. Ha 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 ha! That's it, right? So, it's kind of grotesque. But the thing is that I felt like I needed to write how I also felt my experience, and it was. You know, my mother died, my dad beat me so badly, I stabbed my father, In self-defense, yes. During a vicious beating in which, you know, there's broken bones at the end of it all, my bones were broken, but as a family, later on after it all was over and done and we'd grown up, we were able to laugh about it, a joke, me and my dad and my brother, there's some dark humor, so I wanted to do that. I'd been encouraged. They were telling me, right, we're funny. One of my favorite crime filmmakers is Michael Mann. But the thing that drives me mad about Michael Mann is none of his criminals ever say anything funny. They're all stoic. It's an impression that people have of hardcore criminals. But like I said, most of the murderers I knew, you know, gang of mafiosos, were actually very funny, witty, we like to laugh. Mm-hmm. And so when I would write about solitary confinement, I had to write about the guys in there who made me laugh.
Because they helped you live. That helps you survive.
That helps us laugh, yeah. Because there's just so much terror. And I mean, Flannery O'Connor, I had this quote in my cell on my wall. The maximum amount of seriousness admits the maximum amount of comedy. And that's how I felt was my life. And even to this day, I'm a very serious person, I don't take myself seriously. That's, you know, I'm always laughing, always undercutting myself and trying to see the wit and other people and laughter and things. But when it comes to like dealing with my life, I'm very serious about it, but I like to laugh too much to be too heavy and dark. Even now I want to like say something funny or tap dance or something. I
don't know. So, you know, I read your book while incarcerated for the first time. I read it with fascination because suddenly this person who I'd been corresponding with was revealed to me in a completely different way, and I felt really differently about those letters I was getting from you. Then I found myself transported out of a minimum security setting and into a far worse, prison, and into conditions of confinement that were a lot worse. Still nothing close to solitary confinement, but much, much worse. A place where even more pressure was brought to bear on me. I often say to folks, the last 2 months of incarceration were way harder than the first 11 for me.
The worst.
And I remember feeling incredibly, incredibly desperate during those weeks, and ultimately picking up a pen and being like, there's literally one person on the outside who is going to understand what I'm talking about.
That's where we got a lot of those.
And I wrote to you, and I was grateful. And then that was really close to my out date. And not so long after I came home, we had the opportunity to meet in person, which was, you know, amazing for me personally.
Yeah.
I was just like, thank you, man. And you were like, so when are you going to write about it?
Because remember, in the letters I would write to you, I would say, every night, write something that you saw funny during the day. I mean, going to my Flannery O'Connor thing, write something funny you heard or saw, and then write, you know, just note something serious or something tragic you saw. I wanted you to be like collecting little stuff, mm-hmm. because that's what was helpful to me, was to actually be writing down things that I had heard and mm-hmm. seen and
yeah.
while I was in there.
And even at that point, you know, even though it was just so exciting to sort of be together, you know, in the flesh, I was still like, Joe, I'm not a writer. Like, you know, get off my back on some level. Like, I'm not a writer. That's you. That's not me. You know, you were not the only person who encouraged me to write, but I just sort of feel like you just led by this incredible example in terms of your refusal to consider your experience in the most, in a way that was completely grounded in received wisdom. Of, you know, you have to write a redemption story this way. You have to write about crime or punishment in this way. I just felt like you had big shoes that I needed to step into. So I was grateful for that. And ultimately, you know, your nagging paid off.
It did pay off. My nagging did pay off. You know, my feeling is, you know, I came out of prison. Somebody said, how did you change your life? And 19 years ago, I was saying, I owned my story. Mm-hmm. And I described it like I described it to you. I wrote the narrative down. I recognized patterns, habits of thinking, and I was able to learn about myself, see all the connections. I thought I started coveting money at a certain age. It turned out once I wrote it down, oh, I was involved with coveting money earlier. Oh, I thought I didn't experience much racism as a kid. Oh my God, I experienced it. Like, and I was learning all these things. And so part of my encouragement to you also was, for me, writing wasn't just, I want to get out of prison and stop robbing banks. It was, I want to get out of prison, and I want to reconcile myself with myself, and I want to live a peaceful life in my relationships with people. That was my ambition, not just don't rob banks anymore. And I feel like when you write these stories, when you really go there and you dig deep and you see this stuff, that it's transformational personally, not just how can you own your story so you can move forward and speak to groups of people, but how can you heal yourself? How can you heal your relationship with people? That's what I was kind of always promoting with anybody who I mentor. And that's why I end up becoming friends with everyone I met. I'm like, I'm part of these mentor programs where they're like, hey, can you just read this and give them comments? And Chandra will tell you, someone that I've worked with here, I'm like, I want to talk on the phone with you. How you doing? What's going on? What's in your life? Like, the writing is informed by your life. What's happening? What are you experiencing? That kind of thing. Because I think writing is that powerful. You have to own your narrative.
Right. I mean, one of the things that I'm sort of in awe of, you know, obviously I am not the only person that you've encouraged to write about their life more broadly, but the only, you know, person who has experienced incarceration, the only person who has gone through that incredibly, transformative experience. And so I just wondered if you would elaborate a little bit more about why, I mean, you are very generous with your time and, you know, with your big heart and with your big mind to a lot of people. And why is it so important for people like us to write our lives?
Ah, that's a big question, man. That's a giant question. Well, you know, I'm the son of a preacher anyway. So I'm the son of a pastor, a minister, and I always thought I was going to be in the ministry. So I was raised like my dad. I like to help. It's just like in my DNA. Mm-hmm. And it feels selfish. Like, I like to help people because I like the hit I get. You know, something pops in me. Ooh, I like that. But more importantly, when I was in prison, I was writing my story. One of the things I recognized was that as a man in the world, I had moved and functioned in a hyper-male way, and I was shutting down everything. I mean, part of being the kind of prisoner I was, I really turned everybody into abstractions. Like, people were not flesh and blood to me. Mm. They were chess pieces. Where can I put you? You belong here. Come over here. Come over here. And literally, the bank robberies can be understood as me doing the same thing. Bank manager, come with me. You're taking me to the vault. You, come over here. You need your key. Let's do that. Like, moving people around. It was that sort of people only mattered to me in the abstract. And when I started changing my life, it was that reconciliation with people I wanted. And what I recognized was, every time I had been involved in relationships with women, one of my greatest regrets, more so than even the bank robberies, because I was, the part of the bank robberies that is still the big part of my regret was the terror in my relationship with the teller. Mm-hmm. Not that, oh my God, Chase got fucked out of, you know, $4,000, $12,000. It's the person thing. It's mm-hmm. the image of the terror on the face that is a big regret. But also the relationships I had. And what I wanted when I came out was to listen differently and learn from voices that I had never listened to before. Mm. And it was basically female voices. Hmm. And so I started, and I knew that I would know that my change was real when I started hanging out with women who were smarter than me and saying things once upon a time that I would have been offended by. And then now I was like, oh my God, teach me, teach me, teach me. I would call friends. Now Bernstein was here a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, wonderful.
Now Bernstein's an old friend of mine. I met her. She wrote a book called Burning Down the House. I don't know if any of you were here. Now Bernstein has like a mind like a, it's just the horsepower and bandwidth is intense.
Yes.
And so we would get, and I would come out, and when I came out of prison, I would call her sometimes and say, hey, so somebody said this and they said that. And I think there's like misogyny in there somewhere. Can you help me figure that out? And like, she would like, I was really curious. I wanted to learn. How can I learn from people who know about stuff I don't know anything about or a lot smarter than me? And part of the thing about encouraging other narratives, now it doesn't matter male or female, I just want other voices to inform me at this stage of my life about something I don't know anything about. And in your narrative is your something about you that I want to know about. I want to know about your ambition. I want to know about your desires. I want to know about your resentments. I want to see all that. I want to know. And that's part of the reason I encourage people. Give me what you got and dig deeper. And I challenge people to go as deep as possible to get that stuff out. It's a lot of work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people will tell you who I've worked with, I'm like, pull out more.
Right.
You know?
It's a lot of work in the setting of prison also, especially, I think, because prison and the experience of incarceration, the way that those buildings, that, you know, literally the everything about a prison or a jail, the way it's built, the way that the experience is structured, is designed to make the people inside, both the people who live there and the people who work there, locked down, I think. Locked down emotionally, locked down intellectually.
Yeah, yeah.
In other words, there's nothing about the experience of prison or jail as designed that is intended to open you up. Right?
Granted, but yet you said you wrote all these letters and stuff. How'd you carve out that time to write, to actually do that, to get on the page and write letters and that?
I was just so grateful that anybody on the outside was writing me, that they remembered me, that they valued me enough to make time in their day to write to me. I felt that way about your letters. Like, some total stranger is actually making enough time in his busy day to, like, ask me what the hell is going on with me. So I was very grateful for that. I think that doing the work that you're describing of that kind of writing, which is hard to do, is in some ways maybe even harder to do in a prison or a jail, though of course there is the time.
Got the time all day long.
So I wrote my book because I hoped that people would come away from it with a different idea about people in prison for the very reason you describe. When you talk about the entirety of yourself as a human being on some level or other people, suddenly they are not simply defined as a bank robber, a criminal, a
or
felon.
Or their ID number.
Yes,
yeah.
Your ID number. So you recently came out to visit me, not in Brooklyn, but in Columbus, Ohio, Because
shoveling snow.
Yeah, because I'm out there now spending my time in two medium security facilities, a men's prison and a women's prison. And I'm teaching writing classes. And what we're doing in those classes is reading the writing of people like us who have been incarcerated, or in some broader senses, sometimes touched by the criminal justice system. And also we're reading the writing of people who've worked in the system, people who've worked as COs, people who've worked as prison librarians, some really
interesting
narratives
there.
They're doing time, too.
They're doing time with
us. Who are doing time, too. So the guys, I started my guys' class first, and the first book I assigned for them to read was your book, and
yeah.
You were kind enough to come out and visit with them and visit with me.
That was great. That was so much fun.
And it was tremendous. And I wanted to tell you that the week after your visit, I went to class. You know, it's early on Monday morning. And I said, well, what'd y'all think? Since you got a shot at the author, right? You got to inquire or interrogate the author about his intentions in writing the book, the way he chose to do it, to write a comprehensive story about his whole life, not just a narrow story about your incarceration. And they said, it's pretty crazy to reconcile that guy with the person who stabbed his father in the neck, the person who, you know, did this, did that. And some of your the things you relate about you and incarceration in there, where they were particularly interested in reconciling. thank you for coming to
yeah,
the class in the
yeah,
first place.
Fantastic.
And, you know, just what did you think about the guys and their questions for you?
That's funny. Everyone has always had a problem, like, reconciling. The only guys who didn't ever have a problem reconciling what they saw with my, like, my criminal pedigree were, the guys who were really, really high-ranking mafioso, because what they knew is that kid was 16. He stabbed his dad. Like everybody in this prison got beat up by their dad,
mm-hmm.
and very few people actually attack the guy who's attacking them.
Mm-hmm.
They grow up and they take it out on the world, and that showed a level of like this guy's ferocious. You know, there's they recognize that part of me, but in terms of going back to the prison, we even stopped at one point. So Piper, I was in prison, I get out, Piper goes to prison, we write, she gets out, we meet, that's cool. But then we were like going into this prison together, and now we're hearing the sounds, the doors closing, the keys,
smells.
The smells, the paint chipping everywhere, the buzzers, the intercom, everything. It has a prison smell.
It has a sensory experience, which is incredibly enveloping.
And to walk down the corridor with you was like it was powerful. It was again, the only word I can use is like kind of humbling, that it all comes to this. And now we're going to go talk to guys about what we have done. We write our story. They can do it too. So when I go in there, I see guys who are medium security. So already I know that the advantage I have going to places like this is I say bank robber, and people are like, boom, they stop, they want to listen, they're going to give me all their attention in the world. That in the prison milieu, bank robber is like out here in a weird way. Bank robber is like a kind of a sexy crime. Like the guys who do that, like if I come in there and I'm like, hi, yeah, you know, my crime was that I flayed people and I wore their chest like a vest, people would be like, we don't want to talk to you, man. That's kind of gross, and miss us with that John Wayne Gacy stuff, right? They don't want to, I'm not that guy. But I come in there, and all through Hollywood history, every Hollywood hunk has played a bank robber. From Gable, Paul Newman, Redford, Clooney, like everybody has played a bank robber. Al Pacino. So it's a sexy crime. So when in prison as well, like I've gone into many prison groups with men as many as this, and they see me come up here, middle-aged man, and I'm just here, whatever, and they're like, ooh, and they say, yeah, I'd like to introduce the bank robber. Boom, all the eyes on me, everyone's quiet. It has that kind of thing in there. That what's odd is that the guys in prison who are bank robbers are just like basically a bunch of low-level dope fiends, but it's, you know, this thing is projected on them, and we run with it. So I know I have the narrative that's going to be there and say, by the way, and they've read my book, but by the way, I'm an ex-bank robber, and so let's talk about that at 30 banks, and that immediately gets their attention as well. But the violence, the most important thing is they recognize that in front of them, my narrative, I am a person who, like them, I have a lot of rage in me. I had the requisite rage to do immense amount of harm on guys like them because I was a higher level, maximum security prison, and they're all medium level guys. So going in there already, I have that. So I do the opposite, which is like, let's just talk, let's be friendly. What I had going for me this time too is that you're in there, and these guys love Piper. It was really a kind of a beautiful thing to see. They were already playing with her. They were like joking with her at one point. I hope you don't mind me sharing this one thing because it cracked me up. So was one guy, he's really sharp. I don't know, remember his name, but he says, like, when you were in prison talking to Piper, he was asking a question, and he gets to the point like when you were in prison for 2 weeks, and he made fun of her prison sentence because in prison, one of the like ways you trump other prisoners is like, how much time are you doing? And like, I'm doing 5 years. Oh yeah, you're doing wino time, they say. Like, like you're like spending a weekend in prison kind of thing, right? In a drunk tank, because they're doing 15 years or 20 years. Mm-hmm. So there's that like that kind of positioning and posturing. And they were doing it with her. It was like, and we were laughing and playing around. So that kind of camaraderie that you got instantly with them and that respect was very good. The other thing I liked is they asked great questions. All over the place, like specific parts of the book. What was your choice here? Why did you do that? And they asked a little bit about some of the more glamorous stuff, but it was a good group of guys. I was so happy that they were engaged and legitimately want to do that. They want to. Now, you explain to me again, how did you choose them? How did those guys get to be in that room?
The guys, there's a dozen guys, they all have fairly serious felonies ranging from murder and rape to assault or armed robbery. Doing, again, a range of time from life to relatively short wino time, as you put it.
I don't think 2 years of wino time, personally. 2 years is a chunk of time.
2 years is 2 years.
Yeah.
They all had to write an essay to get into the class, and they simply wrote an essay about an unusual morning in their life. And it was completely up to them what they thought was unusual. Some of them chose to write about something related to their offense, the reason they're there, locked up. Some of them chose to write about their childhood. They chose to write about, you know, a fascinating range. Some of them wrote with just, you know, incredibly entertaining grasp of story. You know, there's a couple guys in there who get narrative structure, like on a possibly a cellular level. And some of them wrote with insight, and some of them just wrote with a lot of emotional honesty. Like, all of them displayed different strengths in the essays that they wrote to get into the class. And they are amazing. You know, I go in there, and we've been up there for like 7 weeks, and you dropped in there right sort of in the middle of there that time. They are.
Oh, it's 7 weeks already.
We are all. Last week we were at 7 weeks, and we're going to have a year with them, and that's amazing because they have stories to tell that will make you cry, that will make you howl with laughter, all of those things, and they are all wrestling with some form of violence and those breaks in their lives that you describe so incredibly well in your own book. And that's particularly interesting for me because you're right, there is a lot going on in that class and in the things they choose to write about that have to do with masculinity in a way that is, for me personally, very novel and interesting, and in a way that I think is completely worthwhile for them to work on and think about, regardless of whether they choose to become writers or, you know, as an avocation or not.
One of the things I liked about that group is often, you know, you got to choose these guys, and they want to be there. They wrote something to get in, and then you picked the ones that you thought would work best. Oftentimes, when I've conducted writing groups in seminars in the prison, I don't like some of them have to be there. It's part of the programming, and so what I would get in there is some antagonisms so that they're not there necessarily to write. Some of them are there and they're still kind of the stuff from the prison is coming into the room. And you can feel there's tensions and people are trying to develop a pecking order in the class. And that's always a challenge to try and work around that. What I loved about your group is I felt like there was a tiny, tiny bit of it, but totally manageable. And in fact, everyone still wanted to work, and they're going to be working through that. And mm-hmm. there seemed like there was something of a camaraderie in there already.
Well, the interesting thing about this place where the class is taking place, the reason that I had to go all the way to Ohio run these classes, is because this men's medium security is a little bit different than some other prisons. And I sort of felt like...
A lot different.
That it was not like going into a desert, because I think a lot of times you go in... I visited a lot of prisons and jails in the course of my life, and sometimes you really feel what incredibly desperate, parched places they are for the people who are struggling to survive inside of them. But this prison, though it is a shitty, medium security state prison in terms of its physical plant, and it is filled with all of the men that we typically incarcerate in places like medium security prisons, meaning disproportionately people of color, disproportionately men from poor communities.
Right.
All those things are definitely true. But I sort of felt like it was a place that was fertile ground for the work that you're describing to take place, because they do things a little bit differently there. You had the opportunity to meet the warden, who is very young, who was trained as a social worker.
I never met a warden like this one. This warden strikes me as the kind of warden, he goes up and shows up at all the warden meetings in the state and like gets bullied probably by all the other wardens. He's such a nice... he has his issues. I mean, he's a warden, but there's some blind spots that all wardens have. But I mean, he gets something very well, which is the outside and the inside. We need to make it more porous so that the outside is implicated in the success of the guys inside. And so he does these things like, but bring your cars in and these guys will fix it. Bring your animals in for daycare, animal daycare, and they'll walk. The inmates will walk them around. The guards do that too. They bring their animals in. They bring their cars in for repair. So the guards are like, what did he say? He said to me, if a guy is going to be walking your dog every day and feeding your dog, you're going to think differently about putting your boot on the back of his neck. I think something like mm-hmm. that, right? It's like there were really thoughtful ways, the plays or whatever.
Yeah.
It was as close to Norway. I've been in the Norway prisons. I actually
mm-hmm.
went and spoke last year in the Norway prison that was mentioned in that article. And Norway was freakish, like freakish. I went to give a talk to prisoners and in like a group like this. And there was a guard there and a guard there and a guard there. And they were looking at me nodding. They were as engaged as the prisoners were. And they were like, they were buddies. They were like, it was, and they were nice. And they came up to me afterwards and thanked me as much as the other people. Like, I'm going through this and I'm going through that. I felt like there was that humanness. It was like the guards were the guards, but with as little power dynamics as possible. It was really startling, like
mm-hmm.
wow, we'd have to really wind things back to get to a place where Norway is in the relationship between the people who confine them
mm-hmm.
and the people who are confined.
It's sort of an interesting, we get so accustomed to sort of operating in the American context of thinking about crime and punishment that when you do go to a place like Norway, which is always held up as the most progressive approach to these questions of crime and punishment, but also places like Germany or Portugal, or there are lots of places that are doing things differently. It's a little bit of a wake-up call. I wanted to talk a little bit about the podcast, The Allure of Crime, which is going to launch in about 2 weeks in April, and hear about like what your cut on that is, because your perspective is unique, obviously.
Yeah.
But also broad, because you have been spending a lot of time in Norway with Norwegian clinicians and writers, and also visiting those prisons. So.
Yeah. So my whole thing when I wrote the book, I wrote the book. It starts from before I was born, my parents meeting. And then it ends my first day out of prison, age 35 and almost 36. And the reason I wrote it intentionally that, we make all the choices, what part, yours was the incarceration,
very narrow. Year, yeah.
Mine was 35 years, almost 36 years. And the reason I did that is I really wanted to show people, look at my life as a text to understand people in prison. That we are not just the crime spree. In fact, the crimes, my crime spree in prison, only take 3 chapters in my book. There's 7 or 8 chapters that have nothing to do with that. Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, there's 1 chapter, is my first day out, that first day that I got out. But my whole approach to trying to be, move in the world and talking about crime now isn't necessarily, you know, policy. I didn't go back to school to get a degree and in the academy to talk about this and write books like that. Because there's people who do it brilliantly. Like, I was a Soros Fellow with Michelle Alexander. Mm-hmm. And Professor Alexander, that's her thing. She does it brilliantly. I'm not that guy. Mm-hmm. But I do feel like the stories that I want to tell and the approach I want to have on crime is, let's humanize that population to people out here. Mm-hmm. Do what they told me to do. Joe, tell them we're funny. Tell them we laugh. And I forgot to tell a story. I do want to tell the story right now. I was in prison 2 days. And I went to Chow Hall, and this big, you know, Chow Hall is full, and it's segregated. It was, you know, whites there, blacks there, Mexicans here, and then a couple tables for other. And
oh, the other.
And so
I always wonder what is
the,
it like?
The other, yeah, exactly. Like, I think they might be Hawaiian. Yeah. Some of them, like, yeah. Whatever. Like
the Native Americans, like Native the America, Southeast Asians. Yeah. Like, oh man, so. Like this is not isolating and lonely
I know,
enough.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I'm there. I'm the second day, maximum security penitentiary in Lompoc, and. This big guy gets up, big ZZ Top beard, muscles, tattoos, you know, just kind of classic biker kind of thing, but like giant guy. And he puts both his hands in his armpits and he goes, quack, quack, I'm a duck. I can't call games worth a fuck. Quack, quack, I'm a duck. And he does it 3 times loud. And it turns, I look at the guy next to me and I said, what is that? Because he sits down and everyone's like, yeah, all right, whatever. And I'm thinking that is the craziest thing. What happens is you bet quack quacks during football season or any sports season. And instead of you paying me, like my friend Joe here, we had a game. He said, what do you want to bet? I would say, let's bet 3 quack quacks in the chow hall. So instead of money, I want to humiliate you by making you go there and say you can't call games worth a fuck, that you're a loser gambler. So that was like the kind of humor like just pops up all over the place in prison. Anyway, the point is that the humanizing thing, my approach is, how can we humanize? Let everyone know that people inside are a lot like people in here. And the pressures on their poise resemble a lot of the pressures on your poise, except they didn't have the skills to manage that pressure. Mm-hmm. And they scooted out in here and they ended up becoming offenders. So my podcast is called The Allure of Crime. It's a tacit understanding that 6-7 out of the most popular TV shows every week are crime shows, from CSI, NCIS, shows I don't watch, Law and Order.
Because some of them are
which
terrible.
I love. I have friends who love Law and Order, boy, you know. So, because I hear it's a great show. But, and or even, you know, reality shows. I'm on, there's an episode of me on I Almost Got Away With It, and it's a very popular show, and they're Locked Up Abroad, all that stuff, which I was watching on JetBlue last night on the way here. So, people love crime. They love crime TV shows. They love crime movies. Every year, Hollywood churns out 1 or 2 heist movies. And now they got like Eisenberg and Aziz Ansari being by. Everybody's a bank robber now. So the bank robbery films or heist films are a big thing. It's in it's in the consciousness. So what I want to do is I want to, with my podcast, I'm starting it off and I talk a little bit about something that's going on in my life. Talk about something that is very human about us. For example, I talked about how I told my daughter that I robbed banks. You know, I finally did when she was 7 years old. It started coming up and she was curious about, she'd heard me talk a lot about things. And did you ever go to prison, she asked, and I had to eventually talk about that. So I talk about how my life choices, things that happened in there, things that happened since. And then the second half is me talking with friends of mine about their favorite heist film or a heist film. And I had Piper and I, we talked about Set It Off. I have Edgar Wright, a friend of mine who's a director, did Shaun of the Dead and you know, Scott Pilgrim, that kind of thing. He's making a bank heist movie this year, in which I will play a bank guard. I'm going to actually act in it as a bank guard who gets shot at a pivotal point in the movie. So going to have a cameo for helping him on the script. And but, you know, friends of mine have written for Ray Donovan. People who have acted in crime stuff. People who have written for Homeland. And we're going to be talking about Hollywood stories and our fascination with crime. So it's like that is me bringing folks in who already have a following, who love to hear these people talk about movies and TV shows. I'll be talking about the culture, crime in the culture, as well as talking about people I know and things I've done and my life as an ex-felon and moving in the world.
Yeah, so these questions of crime and punishment, you're right, are completely central, and yet, you know, most of the 2.4 million people who are actually in that moment of confinement are completely out of sight, out of mind. And so I think it's really interesting, sort of the cut you're taking at it, the approach that you're bringing to
you
bear.
You know, when I was a Soros Fellow, I was on a panel, and this is 2003 or 2005, and everyone was talking about the policies around this and that, and I felt like, you know what you need to do is you need to make entertainment that is about crime, that lets people feel like they can see the humanness, the humanity, and people behind bars. I was making this argument, and I felt like everyone looked at me like, man, you're a dilettante. Why are you talking about this stuff? That's not how you're going to change it. It's going to be hard-hitting journalism. It's going to be, you know, a lot of papers and this and that, and I felt like that is part of it. It's already all there. We need some sort of catalyst. And it turns out Orange is the New Black is that kind of thing, because the Netflix show in particular, and where I realized it, was all these people who all listen talk about it who never did crime will all say, oh, what's fascinating about it is I want fish out of water story. They're attracted to the fact that they would never be there. They don't know how they would be there. But they know that if they were there, they'd be the fish out of water, like the character Piper in Orange is the New Black. And it implicates them. They get there, and now they want to talk. They want to be engaged more. It's altered the imagination of a lot of people about folks behind bars.
They're present in this story. They see how they're part of the story. I think that that was important to me in terms of how I chose to tell it, that narrow, you know, focus on a 13-month thing as opposed to, you know, the story of, you know, middle-class white women, which is very familiar in the popular culture. I think that that's one of the things that I so respect about the way you chose to tell your book, the story in your book, because you insist, you really bring the reader through the life of a young boy who is struggling with, you know, the things he's learning about being a good person in a very religious context, and the things he's learning about being a quote-unquote bad person in terms of, you know, any number of things, including violence, but not limited to that. So I thank you for that.
Oh, thank you.
All right, I think we want to open up to questions. I want to remind everybody of a couple things, though, before we open up the floor to questions, and that is that this is part of a series, and so we're so grateful to the Sackler Center for Feminist Art for launching this series some time ago, focusing on mass incarceration and particularly its impact on women, on children, and on people of color. And grateful we are to that and to the Brooklyn Museum for providing such an incredible home for these dialogues.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful place, a beautiful space. This is the eighth, actually, in the series. And so anyone who is interested can go and check out all of the preceding dialogues and presentations as part of this series, and they are fascinating. I was here last March with three other women who had, you know, been through incarceration, and three women who started really remarkable projects, programs, and talked about leadership in incarceration, and they were wonderful. And all of the programs have been great. So you can check out those videos. And know that this is an ongoing series. So in the fall, in September, we will be back here at the Brooklyn Museum as part of, you know, the Sackler Center for Feminist Art, talking about mass incarceration further. And I believe the first of those fall events will be on September 13th. So look forward to that. Thank you so much, Joe.
Yeah,
thank you for sharing your story in the first place.
Happy to be here with you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great. Great. There are two microphones, stage right and stage left. So if you have a question, just come on down for me, for Joe.
Don't
serious
be shy.
Or silly, because Joe and I are both
serious and ghosts, silly.
Both very serious and silly. All right. Hi there.
Hi. Thank you both for being here. I guess this is a comment and a question. One of the things that I really love about both of your work in contrast to something like Serial, the super famous podcast that everyone was obsessed with, is that you guys seem to really move away from this fetishizing of innocence, right? Both
the
of you.
Fetishizing of what? I'm sorry.
Of innocence.
Yeah.
Right? Both of you don't deny having misbehaved or, you know, you don't deny doing what landed you in prison. And yet still, and I think like in your show, Piper, you know, you show women who are guilty, who have done things that are reprehensible, and yet they're still human and they still deserve, right, our sympathy and our empathy and our care. And I wonder like how you guys think that we can contribute to further undermining that kind of obsession with innocence that, you know, did Adnan Syed like deserve to be in prison for 25 years based on whether or not he committed this crime? Or the bigger, what I think more important question of like, does anyone deserve to be in prison for 25 years? Mm-hmm. Or do we deserve to treat members of our extended community like this, right? Aren't there other ways that we can better their lives? And so like, how do we chip away at this mm-hmm. obsession with innocence as the thing that determines whether or not you deserve to rot in prison or, you know, be a member of our society?
That's very good.
I mean, I really think that what you're talking about is spot on and hopefully is the sign of an evolving conversation, like a conversation that is progressing. So I think, you know, when we think about death penalty reform, for example, we know that the most effective argument about ending the death penalty has been the question of innocence. And we know that many innocent people have been exonerated from death row. And that is one effective way to talk about it. But there is this supposition that people who are not innocent don't deserve empathy and don't deserve a full consideration of their humanity and their possibility for reconciliation and redemption. And so, yeah, I mean, I think that, interestingly, the sort of the counter to that is that the reason I believe people respond to, you know, the story that's told in my book, the story that's told in your book, is that people all have their own failings, their own moral failings, their own bad mistakes, regardless of whether they're crimes or not, that they can reflect on, and that those are big touch points. So people really love a survival story. Americans love a comeback kid. And so that's a really interesting, those are interesting sort of cross currents, like cultural cross currents. I hope that what you're describing is an evolution away from simply saying innocent people are, you know, deserve empathy and the criminal justice system makes mistakes, which is clear, to saying human beings deserve empathy and everyone makes mistakes, and how can we best move towards a place of healing where people can realize their full potential as human beings?
I think it's a great question, but I think the way I look at it is it starts with metaphors, and Willie's a friend of mine. As you know, I'm all about metaphors. Metaphors are how I change my life. I change my metaphors. One thing you'll never hear me say is the word evil. Mm-hmm. I don't like evil because evil implies some supernatural force at work that takes away volition and our choices. But also another word for evil means, you know, the opposite, is good. And once people talk about good and evil a lot, you have the punitive thing is going to come up because you want to get real punitive on the evil. What you're talking about is a problem with punitive nature or punitive instinct. You want to have people care about people who've offended, then you can't be so fucking goddamn punitive every time somebody does something. We're law and order, we got to like, that's what has to change. But the language has to change. In my home, I never used the word evil, not once. And in raising my daughter from the very beginning, anytime she watched a show, it didn't matter if it was Niho Kailan or Caillou or whatever. I knew one day I was going to have to tell her that I transgressed and that the community has embraced me and I made moves toward it and I've been made whole by my relationship with the people who love me. That was a narrative I was always going to tell her. So I spotted it in every little TV show. That I would highlight that. When some little character would mess up and then be ostracized, I would say, watch what they do. They bring them back. And I would tell her, they're not bad. And they're definitely not evil. That's not even in my lexicon. But they're not bad. But they have offended somebody. They've done some offense. But they're going to look at them, get reconciled. From the very beginning, I've been teaching her, you don't punish them. You try and move towards them. You try and, you know, have compassion. Like, that's the thing. That is not taught a lot. In fact, you walk anywhere, listen to anybody on the phone, you're going to be hearing people complaining. He made me do this. He made me do that. He made me so mad. She made me this. Make. Everyone's being made and being made to be angry at somebody and then made to feel insecure and lash out and get punitive in personal relationships. So, of course, it's going to mirror the way society looks at people who do things there and make them upset about it. It's a punitive issue. It's the way we think about being punitive. And I think a lot of the morality stories we have really kind of like encourage some sort of punitive thing. I try to stay away from that sort of punitive stuff as much as possible, which is why in these stories we try to show, yes, they did something wrong and you put them away, but we're not gonna talk about the fact that you put them away. We're gonna talk about, look at the person, look at their relationship to their family, look at their relationship to themselves, their regret, and all that kind of stuff. And that's one of the reasons that show is so beautiful. It shows you their story, how they got there, and it shows you the relation, the complicated relationship to their own narrative, as well as a complicated relationship to the other relationships they have. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, thank you. All right.
Thank you. All right.
So I'm assuming that any mail that comes into or leaves a prison gets read. And if that's
say that again, I'm sorry.
That any mail that comes into or leaves a prison gets read. And
in terms of surveilled?
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. And if that's true, did that present any concerns and or limitations on what you wrote to each other?
I think the truth is, you know, hopefully in most facilities there's a volume of mail which really prevents them from really digging in on it. What they're usually looking for when they open, you're right, every single piece of mail is at least opened, whether it's read or not is an open question. So what they're looking for first and foremost is contraband. So for example, I got, somebody started sending me The Believer in prison, and at some point they sent a version which had a CD attached to it, so I got a piece of official mail saying, somebody sent you contraband.
Yeah.
Little did we know, it was a copy of The Believer.
Like, oh, somebody sent me a chisel in my cake?
Yeah. I doubt that all prison mail gets carefully read unless they're keeping an eye on that prisoner. You know, if prison administration is interested in a prisoner for some reason, then for sure they might read your mail. But they're not reading every single person's mail.
And plus, so, you know, the texture of my language was not something that I think some guard's going to be like, oh, let me get into this guy talking about emancipation and, you know, the texture of your soul and all that. He'd be like, oh, what? I was hoping I could read some, like, you know, sex letter. So this isn't it. Like, you know, so they're not going to be going through all that stuff.
And looking for nudie judies.
Yeah, the landscape of your soul. He's going to be like, yeah, no, forget that. Mm-hmm. Shit.
So you didn't think about it. So you didn't think about it too much. Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. My name is Julie. I have a two-part question. They're not really related, so feel free to answer one or both. One is more of a human question, and one is more of a factual question. So Joe, you spoke very beautifully about reconciling your childhood and being filled with rage. And I was wondering, and maybe that's true for you as well, Piper, what do you do?
I was like, nope.
What sorts of things do you do to stay human and to reconcile that rage, and whether it be meditation or spirituality, what sort of skills can you offer? And then the factual question, you spoke about the Norwegian prison system. What sorts of things do you notice in their country that we're not doing that you think would be best to bring to the reform movement?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I gotta reemphasize, like, the guys in my class were like, wow, that dude is really different.
Yeah, I'm a little different. So the rage thing was in my house, we don't say the word make as well. Nobody makes it. You can't say you make me mad. You can't say you make me happy. We don't say make. In prison, I realized that a lot of the problem I had with my rage was when I started reviewing my life carefully, I could see how I justified every violent act in my life because that person basically, you know, my hands were tied. They did that, and it was the only option available to me. I had to do it. They actually were begging for me to do it because of the way they behaved. In my head, they made me hurt them, victimize them. For the most part, in interpersonal relationships or, you know, when I committed violence other than the bank robberies. So it was important for me to try to come up with a new way of a new metaphor, a new way of saying, what's the dynamic here and how could I change the language? Make implies I had no volition. You compelled me to do it. I had to do it. Mm-hmm. And you lose any sense of responsibility. I wanted to start taking responsibility. So the metaphor I came up with, you did something, and you clearly did something. You called me whatever you called me, but all you did was create the occasion for me to choose to either be mad about it or not care about it. And when I acted, I chose to get angry about the thing that you had created the occasion for, but that had nothing to do with you. Anything I choose to do, anything I do, was my call, excuse me. That changed my life radically, because now I'm in prison and I want to stab the guy in the cell next to me who's just banging on he's like listening in his head to some hip hop and he's banging on his table. And I feel in the past, that noise is intruding in my airspace. That means I have to go over there and I have to put him in check with a knife and say, you do that again, you know, I'm going to have to attack you. I now saw that all he's doing is creating the occasion for me to want to pick up my knife to go over there and scare him. But I didn't have to. And I now, the onus was on me to become very creative about how I dealt with this thing in me that wanted to be punitive and go and show power and all that stuff. Writing was the thing. John Paul Sartre said the most liberating moment of his life was the time he killed somebody on the page. Mm-hmm. And I had read a lot of interviews of Dean Koontz, because I read a lot of Dean Koontz in prison. And he said that the thing that kept him sane was that he got to create all these horrible monsters that did all this terror to people. And I felt like, good, I'm gonna put my rage on the page. I'm gonna make bad stuff happen. So that was it. Meditation too, and yoga, which I don't do anymore, but I did, right out of prison. Norway. Norway's a lot like this prison here. Hmm. Norway, the prison that she's working in that the thought is, these are us, and they're coming out. Mm-hmm. And we don't want them to bring the toxic stuff that is in there. We don't want them to bring it out. And so that's why when I walked in there, what I mostly saw was these discreet people who had toxicity. Because we do. We're so troubled. But I did not feel like when I walk into a prison here in this country, I feel it in the air. I mean, I remember walking out of a chow hall once, and I thought somebody's going to stab me. It's in the air. It's crackling. And I walk a couple steps, and I bend down to tie my shoe, and I'm looking around, and I know something's going to happen. Sure enough, a guy gets stabbed a little bit in front of me. These two guys made a move on him. You could feel it. The toxicity is in the air. Toxicity is in the air. Norway, smaller population prison, because they're trying not to create more surface space for more toxicity to occur. And the more you limit the people who are in there, you limit then the opportunity for that. So that was a big thing, that they limit that. There's not a punitive. And the drug thing, they look at the drug thing. We're not going to send you to prison just because you use drugs. No, you're going to go over here. You're going to get some treatment and that stuff. We would lose 50, 60% of our population right now if we did that. And our population would shrink. Mm-hmm. The surface and contact space for a lot of crazy stuff to happen that then bleeds out through the guards and bleeds out through the other inmates who are there and comes into our community and has an effect on that would shrink. Mm-hmm. If we just let people out and let them go and deal with, well, just forget rehab. Just make drugs legal, and we don't have the problem we have. We don't have the population problem. But Norway was big because of the guards too. Their approach. The guards are not there with guns and guard towers trying to shoot people when they see them get in a fight. It was really strange. Guys talked and they argued, and there was no fighting. And that was it. They got it off their chest, and the guards sat there and didn't say nothing. Just like, okay, that's it. It was like a big family. It was crazy. It was really crazy. Yeah, I'm baffled by how people get to, like, get that, and we have this, you know? Mm-hmm. But the prison where she was at had that, there were so many programs like that. They had a room filled with parakeets. Was it parakeets?
Parakeets or whatever, other birds.
And you get to have a bird in your cell if you want a bird.
You earn the right, yeah.
You earn the right to take care of a bird.
Yeah.
They have what? Oh, you bring your animals in for animals grooming. who have been rehabilitation.
Animal rescue, yeah.
So animal rescue, so they got rabbits and squirrels and all sorts of things in there. I mean, that's amazing in this one prison. I walked out of there thinking this is the model. This is starting to work toward, if you're going to incarcerate people, you want the community to see that these guys are not only responsible for healing themselves, they're responsible for healing a lot of the things in the community in various ways, mm-hmm. healing, you know, in various ways, and have value. More importantly, have value. They could be in there one day, they can be in there for 20 years. They have value.
Yeah.
We need to do more of that. And the humanness. We all, and when you connect with somebody, have sympathy, they have value. You assign to them value now. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. I'd be curious, Piper, what do you think is the most important movement, things to bring over to the reform movement, prison reform?
I think I echo Joe's point that it's incredibly important to get people out of confinement who don't really belong there in terms of the seriousness of their offenses and their propensity for violence, because not only does that confinement not really contribute much to public safety, but it does, you know, make prisons the incredible overcrowding of prisons and jails makes them more violent, right?
Absolutely.
That makes them more violent. That's interesting, that analogy of providing surface area for things to happen.
Yeah, I always use that example. If you have this much surface, only so much things can hit it.
Mm-hmm.
When you make this much more surface, more things can do it. And you create more of a population, mm-hmm. that's more traumas inside there that can occur.
Hold on. There you go.
Cat-like reflexes.
It's all that yoga.
I still got it. No, that's kind of embarrassing, actually. Anyway, the point is that contact surface, mm-hmm. I think of that. That's what we do. We've created more place for traumas to hit people, and then that comes out.
And then, you know, coming back to that question of trauma, what you find, it's sort of acknowledged with female prisoners that you find incredible histories of trauma, victimization, sexual abuse, physical abuse in their histories. But what is totally apparent to me from my time spent in this medium security prison is that when you crack these men's lives open, mm-hmm. the same stories exist, just like
Absolutely.
Joe's story. And so, you know, recognition that the incredibly traumatizing experience of being incarcerated raises all kinds of problems for a group of people who for whom that just triggers all kinds of shit, pardon my French. So that's an inherent problem with the construct of a prison or a jail.
Okay. Thank you.
Cool. Good question. Thank you.
Over here, sir.
Hi. So I did some work up at Sing Sing, mm-hmm. and as part of that, we were shooting a documentary, and there was a point at which myself and the crew were intermingling with a pretty large group of prisoners without any kind of interference from the guards.
Mm-hmm.
And what I sort of took away from it, you know, I talked to a bunch of different, they were surprisingly grateful, or, you know, that just that we were there, mm-hmm. That we were talking with them. They wanted to know what was happening on the outside, any kind of news they were just like really grabbing onto. But what I was sort of ashamed of about my reaction was that, you know, I was interacting with them, you know, as just, you know, you would anybody else, and was able to engage in that conversation. But then afterwards, all I could think of was like, I wonder what that guy did, like, mm-hmm. you know, and I, because we had some inside information, there were some of them that I then found out what it was they did. It was very difficult for me not to sort of judge them based mm-hmm. on that and have some bias towards, you know, afterwards. And I wonder if you ever, you know, you talked about the work you're doing now. Do you ever find yourself judging the person by, like, almost how could you not? And you talked about like, oh, this guy, you know, filleted some people or whatever. Like, is there a different sort of bias in a class where you're teaching and you're sort of like, oh, that guy's really bad, you know, and this guy, I can kind of, I think you get the idea.
Yeah, I think a good question. Sing Sing, of course, is a maximum security prison, so you can be fairly sure that most of the guys you interacted with had serious felonies and probably crimes of violence. I find myself reflecting, you know, we're sort of at the beginning of this process of this writing class with these in the men's facility. In my women's class, Most of the women are there for relatively short sentences and for nonviolent offenses, which is so typical of the women and girls that we incarcerate in this country. Very few women commit really, really serious crimes of violence. In the men's facility and in the men's class, you know, the guys have done much more serious things, and some of them have committed murder, and some of them have committed rape. And that is something that is very interesting for me to try to reconcile. And I think about it every single week, obviously, when I'm, not while I'm in class, but as I leave class and I'm thinking about the work that the guys did, how hard they worked, the stories they told, the insight they may have revealed, the way they're thinking about their own lives and their own stories, and all the ways that Joe talked about so beautifully. But I am thinking a lot about my own reconciliation, especially for the guys who committed the most, you know, heinous or serious offenses. And it's not easy, right? It's not easy, particularly when someone's done something really amazing in class, or I'm also aware of some of the things that these guys, this particular group of guys, are doing in the prison of value, right? And it's incredible. I can only say that that reconciliation to me is everything. Like, that is actually, like, that's where the action is. That's what's fundamentally worthwhile to me as a human being, to go in there and do the work with them. It's, I hope, really clearly, apparently, worthwhile for them. But I also think it's worthwhile for us as a community, because of course, there's a growing consensus that locking people up for things like, you know, drug addiction or even simple drug retailing is pretty pointless. It doesn't get us closer to a a society that has less substance abuse, certainly. but those crimes of violence that most concern us, we don't want to see those things. We want to see people, and particularly guys, not do that stuff.
You can speak French.
Yeah, and so some sense of, like, how can we actually bring an end to those cycles of violence? Because there are cycles of violence. Again, you crack open people's lives, and very few people just get up one day and commit some horrific act of violence, which has no precedent in their lives in terms of being exposed to being to violence or being the victim of violence. So to me, that reconciliation has, like, just an astonishing amount of value, but it's really difficult. Like, I would never suggest that it's the easy, it's the easy stuff. It's the hard, hard stuff.
For me, it was like when I was in prison and I started changing my life, I started seeing prisoners differently. Because when I first went in, prisoners were in a pecking order, and there was, you know, who the prisoners you hated and you hoped bad things happened to them. And when you heard that it did happen, you were grateful and happy. And when I changed my life, I had to start having a different relationship to the men and their narratives. And one of the guys, I knew a killer. He had got drunk and he beat a guy so badly in a bar, the guy died, but that happened 25 years earlier. Now this guy was one of the most ethical men I knew, like real roughly ethical, like just everything was like, Joe, I'm never gonna lie to you, man. So somebody just said this to me and I told him this and your name dropped out of my mouth and I had to tell you right away, and he would find me to come and tell me, like, and he had like that resting grouch, like the, what's the Sesame Street character? The
one? Oscar the Grouch?
Oscar the Grouch. He had resting Oscar the Grouch face. So he was all, even when he was having like, and he was really an intense guy and he had been a killer, but the killing took 5 minutes, 5 minutes of his life. And for the rest of his life, he was considered that. And everyone in the community didn't want him to come out because of 5 minutes. And 25 years later, this is a guy who's leading all the AA meetings, and every guy's coming in and coming out, and how he's helping them get right and get straight and sending them back out into the community healthy, reconnected with their family. And he still had to stay there for 25 years, even though it was only 5 minutes. That's when I realized, you know what? Everybody in this room, if you tracked the worst 5 minutes of your life and you put them in a video and we put it on the screen, you would be ashamed, and everyone in this room would like look at you like, oh my God. Like, we all, if we are the sum of the worst 5 minutes of our lives, we would all be harsh on ourselves. We would be even harsher on ourselves than other people would if we actually condensed them, because we already hate ourselves for a bunch of things that we've done that we know are regrets. But no, we can't define people by that act. Even when Abner Luima was raped by Officer Volpe, when that happened here in New York, I wrote an op-ed when everyone was talking, everyone in my community who like, oh, we need graduations and sentencing and, you know, no mandatory minimums, and like get like people who were very sympathetic towards the person who had offended, and they wanted to make sure that they got the right, you know, calibrated sentencing for their crime. When that happened, they were all like, lock him up forever, you know, life sentence. And I had to actually, I wrote an op-ed that was in the Daily News, I believe. And it's basically said, and man, I got grief for this. I said, if that man did 25 years, do you know what 25 years? 25 years is a long time, and he did this for 15 minutes. 15 minutes of his life, and he's gonna have to deal with it for 25 years. And you're acting like 100 years of life sentence is nothing. I know guys in there like my friend Andre, who was in there, he did this murder which took 5 minutes of his life. He's been in there 25 years. That's 25 years. They should have let him out. And he's never gonna get out because people will come from the community and say, we don't want him out. So my perspective is Officer Justin Volpe did something heinous and horrible. But I look at it as you did something heinous and horrible, and in 25 years, you're not gonna be the young man who was full of rage who did that to that man. When you're in prison for 25 years, he's gonna be somebody else. And already in my imagination, I know who he's gonna be. And so I'm willing to give that when I'm in a group of people and I know that they have done this and this and this and that. I'm like, that's what you did there, and I'm not going to assign that permanently to who you are. That makes sense?
Yeah, I'm just, that makes a lot of sense. The other thing is, do you ever feel almost like guilty that you're enhancing their life experience because somehow you're obligated to the victim of whatever crime it was they committed to make, that their lives are supposed to be somehow miserable because, you know, for like, okay, you're getting locked up, you're supposed to be miserable for 25 years, and then you come in and you're doing a writing program, you're offering reconciliation. Does it ever occur to you that, in other words, like, oh, I'm making this person's life better, and that is in some way a violation of the victim's rights? I'm not saying that's the correct view to have. It might occur to you.
I get it, but you're looking at somebody who, like, I told my wife, I don't care who kills me. I don't care if anyone kills me and they do something really horrible to me. Do not fight for the death penalty for that person. I don't want it for them. I don't care what they do to me. So. And I would be the victim, and so it's easy for me to understand. As a victim, if I was, you know, a victim of any crime, I'm gonna have a different look at the person who does it. I'm gonna try to understand that person's gonna have to go and do something in prison, long time, deal with it, and everything that I went through, another person's gonna have to struggle with. And so from the gate, I wanna give that person as much compassion as possible because that is a long road that they're gonna have to hoe. And it's already gonna be filled with all sorts of landmines and stuff that are akin to sadism. Sending somebody behind prison in some of those environments and with relish is akin to sadism in my imagination sometimes. Yeah. What do you think?
I think about victimization a lot because I think that it is just so incredibly apparent every single time you look at any of these serious offenses. Like you just, like I said, people don't get up in the morning and go out and do something heinous absent like a whole history. And so I'm much more interested in what will break cycles. My personal opinion is that victims and the voices of sort of a broader recognition of who is victimized in this country are largely absent, actually, from the proceedings of the criminal justice system.
That's true.
You know, you go into a court proceeding and the victim is typically very silenced other than several opportunities with the prosecutor to sort of advocate for what kind of sentencing they want. But it's not like they have a great range of choices in terms of how the person who has harmed them is going to be held accountable. It's a very narrow range of choices. And there's very little focus on restorative justice in this country. And I would say that one of the fundamental issues with the way we approach punishment when it comes to prisons and jails is that we take someone who has unquestionably done harm. They may have victimized one person individually, they may have done harm more broadly to the community, and we remove them from we put them in an adversarial position where as a defendant in a court proceeding, all you're working to do is to minimize the penalty that you face. Right? So you're suddenly forced into that mindset right from the jump, as opposed to really considering the harm you've caused. And then once you're incarcerated, The blunt truth, I think, is that most people, most prisons and jails are in fact such incredibly heinous places, horrible places, that all anyone is thinking about while they're incarcerated is their own survival.
That's it.
So you are not generally reflecting on the harm you've caused, on what has happened to your victim, on whether they'll ever be made whole, whether they'll ever feel safe again,
yeah.
Because you are so removed from that person, and you're now experiencing this incredible experience of trauma, and you know this experience of survival, and that's really all you're thinking about, unless you're an incredibly fortunate person and you find on your own steam some kind of space to reflect on the harm you've caused. And that's a big flaw if we wanna actually end those cycles of violence, because yeah. Joe's right, almost everybody who's locked up is coming home someday, right?
Almost
coming
ever.
Back to the streets. So, great question though, that's the heart of the matter.
That's it. Chandra.
All right.
Hi, this is a question for both of you, but in the interest of full disclosure, I wanna tell the audience a year ago this month, I was released from York Correctional Institution, the same prison that Ms. Sackler did all of her work at. I served 6 years, 3 months, and 11 days. So I know the experience. When I was released, I was lucky enough actually to be assigned Joe Loya as a mentor editor through the op-ed project. And my question focuses on what you and I worked on, Joe, which is the Redeem Act. Much of the current criminal justice reform effort focuses on expungement or somehow removing one's record in the vein of making sure that a mistake doesn't follow someone or be held against someone for the rest of their lives. How does that square with your advice to current offenders, people in jail, people who are leaving jail, who your advice to tell them to tell their stories, to own their stories, as you said, Joe, and then be told when they are released or further down their reentry to delete or hide those stories? How does that, those two things for me do not work together.
Well, my feeling is this. The narrative that is going, an ex-con or somebody who's in reentry is going to grapple with is the story that they have in public when they go get a job or something like that. But the one that I found that's more troubling that you can't get rid of by simply expunging it from Google is the narrative that people have about themselves. And that narrative is the thing that always undercuts people and sends them back. I've never met a guy who said, hey, I had to go cop because I kept trying to get a job and they wouldn't give me a job. It works well as a narrative in the movies, but I never met one person who did that. They did it because they were addicted, they did it for other pressure, you know, other things that they had not dealt with. The internal conversation, they didn't have that. And so my feeling is you can wipe everybody's criminal history away from online so nobody can find out that the person looking for a job is an ex-con, and that person is still going to have a relationship with themselves and dancing in their imagination with their regrets and their griefs and all the stuff that drove them to get into prison in the first place. Because most of the guys who went in to get in prison in the first place, when they committed a crime, they didn't have a job. It wasn't because they had a hard time getting a job. Most of them that I knew, especially in the maximum security prisons. So I look at it like, own your narrative and open your narrative and dance with your narrative, like get in there, figure it out. Let other people know, hey, look at it has some value. Because if anything, what I know about these stories, including yours, is it opens people's eyes. It opens people's eyes, especially where there's access points in your story. Because when I wrote my story, the interesting thing in the book tour was people come up and said, oh, I totally related to your story. Oh, but not the bank robberies. Because there's a lot of access points in my story about the death of a mother, about demented religiosity in the home, about physical abuse, sex abuse, just like a bunch of ways where people could hear, they could access my story. So I feel when you tell your story, we're not only telling you people tell your crime story, like in this class, we're telling them, tell your story. Understand that it can be used as a text, just like anything that Shakespeare's written, just like anything that's on TV shows. Like, you know, hopefully don't do it too cheesy, like these reenactments, and I almost got away with it, which are really bad reenactments of my crime spree. But, you know, I think there's power in that. Yeah, that's how I feel about it. You can get rid of all the Google stories about you, but we're all going to have to dance with what's in our imaginations about ourselves.
Yeah. I mean, I think trying to void out parts of your, you know, history, which are really important, even if they were traumatic and difficult and crappy, is probably actually impossible to do. There's a big difference, though, between a private story and a public story and a story that you sort of understand and acknowledge and that resides in your life and one that you sort of put on your resume or, you know, put out there in some incredibly public way. So those determinations have to be made based on safety, based on privilege, based on, you know, a lot of factors, depending on what kind of path you're trying to seek after incarceration. And the one thing that I always, every opportunity I get to talk to people who are incarcerated, and especially to women or girls, I talk to them about their, whatever story it is that preceded them being incarcerated, you know, is important, but they need to have a forward-looking story. I talk to them about that. Like, I'm gonna hit the gate one day, and what's next for me? What do I want? What are my strengths? What can I do that's of value to other people and to myself? And like, what is that story, that story going forward going to be? And I tell them to really work on that story and think about that story and visualize that story a lot.
Yeah, it's good. That's
because they're gonna go home and they're probably gonna go back to the exact same neighborhood and the same sort of situation that they came from. And there's gonna be people in their lives who are like, oh, this story is bull, because I know who you really are. You're that person, and it's gonna be really grounded in the past. And so they have to have a lot of confidence in that story so they aren't knocked off balance by people confronting them with the old story. And I think that's really important. I mean, I think people talk all the time about visualization being a really important part of success and achieving a goal. I think that's exceptionally important for people who are in the midst of confinement and are looking to go home.
Excuse me, Piper and Joe, I just wanted to give you the 10-minute mark.
All
so
right.
As many questions as we can get in 10 minutes.
Okey
thanks.
Okey-dokey. Super. Okay. Hello, sir.
So, hi, Piper. Joe. I was very much taken with your, Joe, and particularly when you spoke about your colleague in prison, the gentle giant who you know, killed somebody during a drunken rage but has been basically an ethical person since, and maybe before, but yeah. And I think as a society, we are finally, Americans are finally beginning to sense, not just, you know, in liberal states like New York, but across the country, even conservatives are beginning to see that we incarcerate too many people for too long, for too little purpose. Yet, the question remains for me, for other people, what about the truly sociopathic, psychopathic people who kill not in one moment of rage that's out of sync with their life, but there are people who really, they're really evil people in the world. I mean, my particular...
The people who commit offenses in the world, yeah.
You know, really, I mean, the example in my mind is the gang members who executed the police officers in Staten Island in cold blood. And you know, if there's any crime that to my mind is deserving of capital punishment, maybe that's it, as compared to, you know, your general giant who had 5 minutes of rage. So how can you talk about what can be done for people like that, that pretty much everyone agrees we don't want them out there in society at large?
That's a larger conversation. So I'm just gonna say two things about that. One, I have a lot of friends who are prison abolitionists who believe we shouldn't incarcerate anyone, and I'm not that. But everybody I know who has done serious time and committed serious offenses and is now out and has done some radical stuff to alter the trajectory of their lives and contribute in ways, raising their family, being there, whatever. All of us who have done time and serious time, like some of these guys are ex-dropouts of mafias and stuff like that, we all know that there's a certain percentage of people who don't play well with others. And we were that for a moment. But there just are. Some people, and even us who were that, have a challenge understanding what do you do with them. You just, for a while, you just, all we can think about is this, put them there. None of us think you kill anybody for anything they do. None of us. We believed that when we were actually prisoners. We thought certain sex offenders, when they got killed, we were happy. But we don't believe in the death penalty, but we also do believe that there is a segment of people that we know, that maybe even we were at one time, that don't play well with others and can't be trusted to make choices out here. That's all I can say about it, because it's a really long and complicated conversation. We got 10 minutes, but that's my thing. I don't believe in death penalty, and I'm not an abolitionist as well, so I'm in the middle. Some people need to be there for right now until we can figure out.
Okay. I want us to get the last question before we're out of
time. Thank you.
Great.
Hi. So I was wondering if you could speak to the kind of dual facet of the fact that prisons are sort of flattening, both to the criminals and to the guards, mm-hmm. in that they have very distinct roles. And yet the people who go into them on both sides come from contexts usually of poverty, extreme sort of horribly violent masculinity. And so I guess I was wondering if you could speak to the sort of state of mind between the prisoners and the guards regarding the fact that many of the guards have had similar experiences, commit similar offenses in the prison, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting when you talk to people who are correctional workers, you know, broadly, you know, especially line staff, you know, sort of, you know, COs and so on and so forth. What you often find, you talk to them, they're like, oh, I've got family in prison, you know. You're absolutely right. You know, both the people who are incarcerated and many people who work in corrections come out of the same milieu. I managed to squeeze in a French word.
Yeah.
And that's really interesting in a lot of senses. It is, of course, very difficult to conceive of a less equal relationship than the relationship between a prisoner and a prison staffer, whether that's a CO or somebody else who works inside of a prison. And so that power differential leads to all kinds of crazy stuff. And often by saying crazy, I mean horrible, though sometimes very funny and strange.
Yeah, yeah,
you know, it's not all, you know, all of those interactions are not colored by violence and abuse. Sometimes you have incredibly beautiful moments of humanity between prisoners and staff, and those are worth relating.
Yes.
Though I wouldn't call them the definitive norm of how things are structured. What do you think about the masculinity piece? Because I'm just dipping my toe in that masculinity piece personally.
Okay, I'm going to give you a small answer. A soupçon. You see, French. A soupçon. What's interesting to me when you talk about the relationship that they have, and they come from the same milieu, of course, but also, more importantly, they come from the same frame of mind around morality. When you listen to a prison guard talk about how he has a certain generosity towards inmates and how he thinks that they can change, you're going to always hear him talk in the term morality of religion and the redemption story, always. He believes that his God allows him to believe that these prisoners, they can find Jesus. And the prisoners, when they're in prison and they change their life, what's really remarkable, how many of them do it and it's underwritten by religion. Like, I'm the only person I know who made secular change. Like, I didn't have God or any Allah or anything to pray to. So what's interesting to me when you ask that question is, look at, they're the same in there, and how do we get it so that they're not flattened? I ask the same question. How can we get it so the only way we can understand prisoners is through a religious morality? And the only way you can get better, and we could look at you as be better, is you got to find God. And I'm not saying you can't find God, but that's where we are. That's the reality of it. A lot of people have that, and they're kind of... And to me, that flattens them too. I love the fact that you talk about that prison flattens us. But that said, we have turned ourselves into cliches before we went in there, and we flattened ourselves. We did not allow for enough texture in ourselves to think we had other options. And so we walk into that. One of the complaints about that I read about Orange is the New Black is they said that some of these characters were cliches. And I laughed. My first response was, to a friend was, we are cliche. I was a walking cliche. I was a fucking walking cliche. We are cliches. So it actually characterized who we are. We don't have that imagination. We flatten ourselves. I love that word. That's a good way to describe it.
What I like about that term flattening is that, you know, you may have meant all kinds of things, but that two-dimensional quality of like playing, like there is no place more obsessed with role-playing than a prison, right? I am playing the role of prisoner. I am playing the role of jailer.
It's all performance.
It is incredibly performative, and the interactions between prisoners are incredibly performative in terms of like securing your own safety or perceived safety. So, you know, anything that allows for people to actually inhabit their three-dimensional selves is a good thing. And so many of the things that Joe has described and that you know, that I've perceived on the positive fronts, you know, do have totally to do with that recognition of people as three-dimensional characters. I would say that the most three-dimensional interactions that I've ever seen or experienced between prisoners and prison staff are often around work rather than religiosity.
Yeah, yeah.
And so those were often the meeting points when prisoners are allowed to work and when they work under, you know, for, you know, correctional officers who are primarily responsible not for supervising them as prisoners, but for supervising them as workers. That was often where you found sort of the most human interactions in my experience.
Yeah.
Okay, good question.
Very good question. Thank you, everybody.
We could answer all night, but thank you so much all for coming. Very much appreciated.